This video is an update to an older video that I had. The older version had a mistake in it, so I went back to correct it, and then I noticed it could use some additional clarification, so I decided to recreate the whole thing. Understanding the system performance curve is only half the equation, so to speak. The other half is how a given pump performs within our system. This video is an initial list of considerations one would make when selecting the right pump. The figure at the right shows an example of a pump's performance data. The system performance curve is the solid gray line that is curving upwards on the chart. The pump performance curve is the solid black line curving downward on the chart. The point where the system curve and the pump performance curve intersect is known as the operation point. This intersection point shows where the pump will operate, meaning it shows how much flow rate and pressure head the pump will deliver to our system. It would be fantastic if we could run the pump precisely at the point where it is most efficient, also known as the best efficiency point, or BEP. However, that is rarely possible. So we are shooting for good enough. The good enough place to run a pump is between 60% and 120% of the flow rate corresponding to the BEP. On this chart, the BEP is located by drawing a line vertically from the max efficiency point on the curve to the pump performance curve. The corresponding flow rate is read from the x-axis. In this example, the QBEP is 5,800 gallons per minute. So the operating point should be between 3,480 gallons per minute and 6960 gallons per minute. In this example, our operating point is at 6800 gallons per minute, so we are good with this parameter. When we talk about efficiency, what we are talking about is the difference between the power applied to the pump shaft compared with the power observed in the fluid. In other words, if we set a flow meter immediately downstream of the pump where we will be able to measure the flow rate and the pressure head generated by the pump, if we multiply that by the unit weight of the water, gamma, then we can compute the power in the fluid. To make this equation more friendly to imperial units, you might see this version where gamma times Q times H is divided by 550 so that the power estimated is in horsepower. We call this the water horsepower, or WHP, because it is calculated by using observations made on the fluid itself. In a pump test, we can use a brake to apply a torque to the pump shaft and observe the speed or rotations per minute of the shaft to compute the brake horsepower. This comes out as torque times the pump speed N times 2 pi divided by a conversion factor of 396,000. The brake horsepower is the quantity of power supplied to the impeller, which in turn is supplying power to the fluid. There are losses as power is transferred from the shaft to the impeller and to the fluid, so the pump efficiency, which is sometimes written with the Greek letter eta or the Roman letter E, is simply the ratio of the water horsepower divided by the brake horsepower. Efficiency data is provided on the pump performance chart, so we can estimate the brake horsepower by drawing a line vertical up from the operation point to the BHP line and then horizontal to read the value from the y-axis. The difference between the water horsepower and the brake horsepower is simply the efficiency of the pump. So if we include the pump efficiency into the denominator of the WHP equation, we get this version of the brake horsepower equation, written as the specific gravity of the fluid times the flow rate times the head divided by 3960 times the pump efficiency. When we are working with water, the specific gravity is 1, and the flow rate units are in gallons per minute, which is the most common unit used for potable water systems. This version of the brake horsepower equation is helpful because when I took the professional engineer's licensing exam the first time, there was an equation in the morning breath section that gave me the flow rate, head, and the pump efficiency and simply asked for the brake horsepower. Needless to say, I panicked. Then I went scouring through every textbook I brought, wasting time only to give up and guess C. And that's probably why I had to take the test twice. Anywho, if we wanted to know the total horsepower to run the pump, then we must also account for the motor's efficiency. Put another way, power comes to our motor from the wall. The motor converts the electrical power into mechanical power by turning the pump shaft. As you can imagine, there are losses in this conversion process, similar to the losses observed when transferring power from the pump shaft to the fluid, and those losses are accounted for in the E sub M term shown here. I have included both forms of the equation for total horsepower so that you can see the flow rate units and conversion factor for when gamma is included, and the flow rate units and conversion factor for when gamma is not included. We want to know the total power required to run our pumps so that we can determine the operating cost. 1 horsepower is equivalent to 0.746 kilowatts. Power costs are typically listed as how many dollars per kilowatt hour, so finding the cost of operating the pump is just a simple conversion problem once you know how to compute the pump power. I will cover an example of how to estimate pump operating costs in a separate video. The third consideration is the net positive suction head. This concept is important enough that I covered in a separate video as well. There are a couple points I want to discuss here. First, the amount of net positive suction head required, or NPSHR, to safely operate a pump is provided by the pump performance chart here as the black line at the bottom. Starting from the operation point, draw a line down to the NPSHR curve, then horizontally to read off the value. In theory, a pump selection is suitable if the amount of net positive suction head available in the system is more than the net positive suction head required by the pump. However, in practice, we civil engineers are a conservative bunch, so when we are working with water, the NPSHA must be greater than the NPSHR plus an additional 5 feet. When we are talking about pumping raw sewage, we add 7 feet to the NPSHR. If a pump fails this check, then the pump is typically disqualified, or you have to revisit the system design to increase the net positive suction head available in your system. I will go over how to compute the net positive suction head available in another video.